Greetings, fellow investigators, and welcome back to our video podcast, Into the Darkness, where my friends and I play the Call of Cthulhu role-playing game. I'm your host, Tom Rayleigh. A rather famous horror writer, Stephen King, maybe you've heard of him, says in his book, It, sometimes human places create inhuman monsters. Our campaign is Horror on the Orient Express, and this is episode 52. I'm your Game Master, and Jeff Wilkins will be giving our recap. So hold on to your Cuda Vistas. The players are ready. Let's begin our journey into the darkness. Jeff.
Thanks, Tom. Wednesday, February 7th, our investigators are looking into finding the author of an article that appeared in the newspaper. Eldridge and Rupert managed to get the address of the woman named Vanessa Femick. We grab a cab, go over to her home. While the rest of us wait outside, Eldridge approaches alone. But when he gets to the door is slightly open already. It looks like our home's been broken into. We enter cautiously. The room has been ransacked. We find two teeth that have been knocked out. Upon further searching, we notice that all her research papers and photographs have been taken. We do find her jacket on the back of the front door. Inside of the pocket, we find a little notebook. In the notebook is the name of one of her sources named Lazar. Eldridge finds another note where Lazar is asking Vesna to meet him at the, quote, Rose Garden, which we learn is a cheap motel in the area. We take the taxi to the Rose Garden and the off chance that maybe we'll meet Lazar or Vesna there. We ask the woman at the front desk if she knows either of them, and she confirms that she has seen both of them, but that they're not here now. We thank her and we take our leave, and on the way out, something catches Frank's eye down the alleyway. Turns out there are two bodies that have been rolled up in a carpet and stuffed in the garbage. Upon looking into the carpets, we see the horrifying sight of two skinned bodies. On top of the gruesome sight, we start to put things together and realize that the skinless cult is here in Vinkovice. What's more is that we're realizing that maybe they are using the skins of Lazar and Vesna to impersonate them. Paranoia sets in, and we start to wonder if maybe Jasmina has been compromised as well. We head back to our lodge to regroup and see if we can figure out what's going on. As evening presses in, we're all reminded that we still have the cement factory to look into. It's on the outskirts of town. We think about maybe going to sneak around at night, but then decide against the idea that maybe daylight and being open about our questioning is the best move. So with that, we head to bed. Later that night, Frank's having a difficult time getting to sleep after seeing some of those horrible skinless bodies when we hear something stirring out on the balcony. He manages to wake the guys, and immediately we're on high alert with our weapons drawn. Suddenly, the window bursts open, and there's a large black figure with the head of a boar. Without hesitation, the group unloads. We seriously injure the creature as it turns to escape. We get a good look at the thing, and it seems like it's made from various parts of different animals. The thing leaps to the ground and then runs. We all head outside, chase the beast down. It's wounded and we catch it when it collapses against a tree on the edge of the woods. Dr. Dawkins gets a good closer look at it and sees the creature is made up of various animal parts, but that the parts are joining seamlessly. There's no signs of stitches or the like. As more people are now joining us from the lodge, that's where we ended our episode. That brings us up to date.
All right. So as you guys stand there in the cold of the early, early morning in the snow, in front of you is this dead and bloody creature, twitching still, but definitely dead. People have followed you out the hotel. From the gunshots, people are now coming from other buildings, and a crowd is beginning to slowly form around.
I, I'll push my way through to the crowd because I went running back in because I only had my silk pajamas and a cravat on. So I've put on some more sensible clothes very quickly to come out of my heavy overcoat. And that's how I'll push my way through to the crowd to get to my companions.
Okay.
Yeah. Ugly bastard, isn't he?
I will, as you're running towards the lounge, or the lodge, I should say, I'll scream out or I'll yell out to you to get some other people to help me bring this thing in.
Yeah, for sure.
Well, go ahead.
I'm going to stand around until help comes to help me.
Oh, well, I go running back to the lodge again. And I'll see if they've got something like a stretcher or something in their emergency medical department of the hotel or something. If they've got some sort of stretcher I can bring back and maybe we can get a few people out of the crowd to give us a hand.
Well, by the time you've even just
and
begun,
some blankets to throw over the body as well.
Before you can get any of that done, the police are arriving.
Oh, I won't bother them because they do all that. I just have a cigarette and look like dejected.
So, the police obviously pull up in their little old-fashioned police cars, and if you recall, there's kind of a curfew because of the bombing that went on. Mm-hmm. A number of police officers come out. They, of course, push through the crowd to where you guys are standing and this body. Actually, let me give you an opportunity. Do you want to be standing there when the police arrive?
But they're going to come looking for us probably if we don't. I mean,
yeah, I don't think we need that.
Dr. Keith's staying in the hotel room just in case this is a diversion.
Yeah, I'm staying around.
Well, yeah, if you are, we'll be. I've got permits.
All right. So the police push through the crowds and they say, what's going on here? What's going on? And they see the thing. And each policeman, maybe there's three of them as they come forward and see this thing, they're rather shocked. One of them asks, what happened here? And the other two sort of turn around and start to tell people, nothing to see here. Go on, go home. Mm. Go back to bed.
Like, try to break into the lodge where we were sleeping. We opened fire on it and it came this far because of its wounds.
So you were in the lodge and you fired on this thing? It came through the window?
Certainly did. It was breaking in. And as soon as I saw it, I grabbed my gun, which I got the paperwork for in the hotel. And I opened fire on it.
Now, very
none of my companions opened fire on it. Only me.
Let me see if I can explain. This doesn't seem out of the ordinary. Mm. But what they do is, first of all, they cover the thing up.
Yes, of course.
At least two of the policemen look frightened, you know, like, oh my God, it's a monster. You know, what the hell is it? And the other one is trying to keep his composure.
He's professional.
But, the police are going to take care of this. If there's any questions, where can you be reached? You're staying at the hotel?
I'm staying at the Lodge Fair. I'll give him my name, Rupert Hamilton Smythe. I'm the only one that opened fire upon it because my companions didn't have any firearms. So, the bullet wounds are down to me. Right. So I'll be at the lodge if you need me at all. I'm a citizen of the United Kingdom.
All right. So he takes down all of your information.
I'll be as cooperative as I can. If he wants to see my gun papers, I'll even go back to the hotel and get them.
And he's like, let us take care of this problem right now. And then we might send somebody around tomorrow morning to question you.
Of course. Should we go in the warm and do this?
What's that?
Should we go in the warm and do this, or do you want to do it outdoors here? Sorting out the questions.
Go back to your hotel and wait there, and in the morning somebody will come and speak with you.
Okay.
Right now, we've got a stuff to worry about.
Thank you very much, officer. Thank you for coming so promptly.
All right. Just as you are leaving, another car pulls up, and you notice that same man who was in charge when you first got off the train, who asked you a bunch of questions. You don't remember what his name was, but you know he was like captain something or lieutenant or something something, but he seemed to be in charge, and you see him coming out now.
Tend not to see him and head back to the lodge.
All right.
If he sees me, it's one matter. I'll just pretend I haven't seen him.
So you guys, and he looks like he just got out of bed. I mean, he's bags under his eyes. And
anyone fancy a brandy? I know I can do a bloody brandy after that. Get to my case now, and get my brandy out.
About 3 o'clock in the morning, so...
I know, but I'm not going to get to sleep again after this.
No, I'm just telling you that. What do you guys want to do? You're going to go back to your hotel?
Sit down and have a nice large brandy and sit there and talk to each other about what happened and let it sink in.
Yeah, it sounds like a good plan, actually.
What was the demeanor of the police questioning us? Were they treating us kindly or with respect, or were they...
They were being rather gruff. At the moment, the entire police force is preoccupied with trying to find this People's Liberation Army that they suspect is behind the sabotage of the tracks. So they've been, 24 hours going. And in this case, these policemen seem like they're... All they seem like is that they're extremely disturbed by what they've just seen, but their job is to get everybody to go back away, and then they'll let the higher ups take care of it.
And I'll make sure my companions know that to say they didn't open fire on it, to let me just deal with the gun incidents. Yeah, keep getting their guns hidden or smuggle them somewhere and hide them for the time being.
Well, you don't need a license to have a gun in...
It's just if anything does crop up from it, it's only better if one of us gets into trouble than all three of us.
Mm. All right.
So sure, I'm happy that you're doing that.
But I'm sure you can get bail money for
me. You know?
All right, so you're back at the hotel, and of course, the dining room is full of people. Everybody is talking about it. Did you see the thing? I couldn't see it. I'm too short. I was in the back of the crowd. What did it look like? It looked like a monster with a boar's head, and it was a Cuda Vesti, and that's all that everybody's talking about.
Understandably.
Nobody knows who shot it, because obviously they weren't there when that happened.
I'm not going to announce it to them. That's all right. Yeah, only sort of the police sort of thing. I'm wondering, I don't think we made sanity checks for saying this thing.
Yeah, go ahead.
So maybe now it was time to sit down. Maybe we should make one to see if it sinks in or not.
Yeah.
Thanks, Rupert.
Well, I remembered last week we were meant to do it, and I don't think we got round to it. I failed.
Yeah, I made it.
Oh, wow.
I got a heart roll on that, too.
Yeah. If you made it, just take one. If you didn't make it, do a
1d4.
This is solid, absolute physical evidence that this thing, this isn't a ghost, it isn't a specter, it isn't a vision.
That puts me down to 67 on the sunny.
Okay.
But yeah, I need a brandy. My hand's shaking a bit, but everything's all right.
All right.
Surprised I hit it, actually. I was surprised I hit it, and I was surprised my bloody gun worked this time. Last time I used it, it didn't work.
Yeah, I've tested it since then, haven't you?
Well, no, I haven't, actually. I flew around with a bloody thing all those years, and all the while it wouldn't have worked if I'd used it. Damn annoying.
All right. Actually, only I would say about 30 minutes pass. and you're still downstairs, and you now notice this head cop and two lieutenants come to the front door of the hotel, and they can see that everybody is up.
I stand up from our table or our chair, circle the chair, so they can see us.
One of the younger guys points over at you.
And
they all start moving towards you.
Make sure there's enough chairs for them as well. Okay, how old you are, get out.
All right. He walks over, and he's rather matter of fact. He's not polite. He's not impolite. No, he's obviously tired.
But he is aware he's dealing with a gentleman.
And he says, excuse me, but it was my lieutenant here says that it was you
who shot the thing. Of course it was me, yes. Yes, I did.
He says, my name is Captain Velimir Karku.
My pleasure, sir. Karkanicha. I'm sorry about the circumstances.
Velimir Karkanicha.
Do you, Vladimir?
Karkanicha. Velimir.
Velimir. May I call you Velimir, please?
You can call me officer.
Officer, thank you.
Captain.
Thank you.
He's not laughing. I'm laughing. I don't know why I'm laughing. He's not laughing. He says, could you tell me what happened, please?
I was finding it difficult to sleep, which is insomnia, a bit of a problem I have from the last show. But basically, I heard this thing on the balcony. At first, I didn't really think much of it. No, I heard it sort of pushing against the door like it was trying to be forced. This made me to get out of bed and try and alert my companions. Before I knew anything, it kept bursting through. Luckily, as I was on my feet, I could get to the bedside cabinet and reach for my pistol. And I opened two or three shots in this general direction. That seemed to change its general mind about things and it turned and fled. But I guess I winged it because we followed the blood and that led us to where the body was.
All right.
Terrifying experience.
He looks at you with a quizzical look and he says, weren't you the group that was on the Orient Express the other day when...
I do believe we have met before, maybe a few days ago.
And he's like, well, I told you to stay in the hotel. You know, well, I told you that it's
dangerous out there. This is a hunting lodge, and a friend of ours basically wanted to stay here because she's grieving, and we agreed to stay here with her to keep her company in the hunting lodge, which is kind of a hotel, you must agree.
All right. I just find it suspicious that you are involved in this, and you are also, we're traveling on the train.
But you can see from the lodge balcony at the doors, and we're forced, and the creature brought the fight to us, officer. We didn't bring the fight to the creature. I would go out of my way to avoid the creature. It looked like that. I'm quite surprised we got away with our lives. I would have thought some sort of demonic creature like that wouldn't be able to be hurt by bullets. It was only by instinct that I fired.
Well, it's...
I do apologize for that.
It's quite obviously an animal of some sort.
What was it? Have you seen that before?
We don't have any idea what it was. Probably some sort of weird... I don't know. It's probably something that has to do with the Liberation Army.
Well, as a God-fearing man, I thought it was a demon of some sort.
Well, you should have been more careful because it could have been a person in a costume. But if it was somebody breaking into your room, then I can understand why you were using self-defense.
Thank you, officer. It won't happen again, hopefully. I'd like to think no one
is going to attack. Is there that you can tell me?
I'm aware of. I mean, I've never seen anything that looks like that before, and why the thing would try to pick on us to attack her, I don't know. Whether it was actually I or my companions were the targets or somebody else in the lodge at the time.
Well, is there any reason why you would be targets?
Not that I'm aware of, officer. We're on vacation, believe it or not. I mean, it's a fun-filled vacation, but we're still enjoying your country, and we're not going to be put off by what's happened and our reflections about what a wonderful way we've been treated since we've come to this country.
Well,
such a fine culture and a rich heritage.
I would like you to do a persuade roll.
Anything I regret actually, is not been able
actually
to
say a charm roll.
A charm roll,
eh? You're really trying to charm him, so.
I've got charms. Well, I succeed 42, and my charm is 55.
Okay.
Nice. Hello.
They're getting ready to vote for you for mayor.
Well, he says, all right. He says, we'd like to go upstairs and examine where this took place, if you don't mind.
Of course. And here's my personal card, just in case you need to contact me in the future about any inquiries.
All right. And he takes your card. You know, you don't have any reason why this thing would be coming after you. Are you?
Honestly, I am as confused as you are. And I mean, the sooner you find the answers to these questions, the better off I am, because how could we expect this?
Well, this is definitely some sort of mystery, which we don't have time to work with right now. We're very busy trying to find this.
Which is why I give you my card.
It's actually the People's Justice Army. We have the national military are on their way. We expect Major Boscovich to arrive in the morning with troops, and he has. You don't want to cross him or
of course not. Of course
get in
not.
His way. So if there is anything that you know or anything that you can point us in the direction of, you'd be much better dealing with me than with him. He's a dangerous
person. Of course. Like I say, you've got my card, so if you need me in the future, don't hesitate to contact me, and I'll see what I can do to help the People's Liberation Army in any way I can. Just strictly a tourist. So no way do I want to create ripples at all while I'm here.
What did you just say? You want to help who?
Is it the People's Liberation Army? Or
those are the terrorists.
the organization he belongs to. Sort of.
He's a police officer.
Yeah, a police officer. I thought that was for who he represented.
No. The People's Justice Army is the ones that they think that...
Oh, yeah.
And actually, at this point, I mean... I don't know whether you have been careful or not, but you are aware that because of that newspaper article and the fact that Dr. Morick has been murdered, the police are of the opinion that it was probably something because Dr. Morick was probably in league with the People's Justice Army, and something went wrong and they ended up executing him. Where is his daughter? Because we'd like to talk to her. And
yeah, but I'm an Englishman. I can't speak the local language. So if I can't speak the local tongue, why would I be bothered with the local politics? I'm strictly a tourist. It's none of my business. I'm doing is vacationing.
In any case, if you know anything, please give us a
call. Of course, officer. Of course.
And then he turns around with his people, and they question a few other people in the crowd, you know. Where were you? What did you see? Blah, blah, blah. So what do you want to do? It's now about 4 o'clock.
I
was going to ask, do we notice, are they specifically asking other people about us?
No.
No, clarify, you said...
The questions that keep coming up that you keep hearing... all have to do with this People's Justice Army. They're completely devoted at the moment to trying to root out all the members of this People's Justice Army and bring them to justice for blowing up the train and for other things that they've done.
There's no reason why an Englishman would be involved with that.
No, unless you're lying and you're not English and you're one of them. You're a Croat.
Croat. I think they tell by the accent.
All right. So it's about 4 a.m. What do you guys want to do?
Try and get some sleep once the police have finished with our room.
Yeah, they go upstairs. They examine the damage.
Do we get moved? We can't get moved at all because it's only a lodge. It's only a hotel. So try to secure the door the best way we can. Has anyone got carpentry skills?
The people who run the place.
They're going to do that, are they?
They patch things up. All right. So you guys are going to go back to bed? Or, I mean, you tell me.
Try and get some sleep, but I don't know how successful.
All right. So we'll assume that you get some sleep. You sleep until about 7:30.
Hopefully we still catch breakfast.
Probably not. By the time we get up, it'll be... Right. Well, it depends on how fast we sleep. How long we sleep, so...
Well, you get up at 7:30... You get down to breakfast at 8 o'clock, and there is a slight problem, and that's that a lot of people just stayed up and ate breakfast, and they ran out of a lot of things in the morning.
Is there a cafe nearby then?
There probably is. Yeah,
well, let's get to a cafe for a change of scenery. Fuck them.
All right. Now... You walk to the cafe, which there's a cafe just down the street. It's not a huge town, so everything is kind of just down the street. Mm-hmm. I would like you all to do spot hidden.
No way. 89.
I got a 92.
I'm on 4.
I don't know about those dice there, Wayne.
Jeff, did you get anything?
I passed, yeah. 48 out of 65.
All right. Jeff, when you were walking from the scene of the Cuda Vista back to the hotel, there were a number of police cars that were parked there. But there were a couple of other cars as well. From people who had been, I don't know, doing something, and they saw what was going on, and they were curious, obviously. Mm-hmm. One of those cars was rather distinctive. I'm not going to say how, because I can't exactly, I don't know cars that well back then, but we'll just say that it was a different kind of different make and model than others. And it just stuck in your mind sort of subconsciously that you saw that car. Maybe you thought, oh, that's a nice car, whatever.
Okay.
So as you're walking to the cafe.
Can I make a note? So with all this that has happened with the creature and all, I'm curious if I might get a look at it somehow, because I'm going to bring my camera with me. If I can get a picture of that thing, that would be awesome.
Okay.
So I'll be carrying it around with me.
All right. It's obviously not where it was.
Yeah, that's what I was expecting.
So, as you're walking on the sidewalk, a car turns a corner and starts coming towards you, going past, and it's that car, that distinctive car. And as it goes by, you can see the passenger in the back seat rather clearly. It's a woman. And you're pretty sure it's Vesna Femic. Or at least it looks like Vesna Femic.
Do I have time to nudge my compatriots?
What's that matter, old boy?
Did the car go by too fast?
Yeah, they can't see it. It's by now.
I didn't notice it. So I was looking at that shop window.
Hmm.
What did you see?
I think I just saw Vesna Femic.
Oh.
Remember that photograph you had of her?
Yes, I did. I still got it, actually.
I think I just saw her in the back seat of that car.
Well, spotted old chap. Can you see where the car went?
It's turned a corner down the street.
Damn it, Blas. If it comes back again, hopefully we'll pick it up. We'll have a coffee and a breakfast and keep our eyes peeled for it, shall we?
Mm-hmm.
I think you can sit outside of these cafes
Not when it's 23 degrees outside.
Yeah. Oh yeah, I forgot about that. I forgot about the weather. I keep running around in my pajamas and stuff. Well, we sit near the window if we can and have a breakfast and some coffee and croissants or whatever they eat around here.
Okay. Probably something Slavic.
Well, whatever it is, I'm sure it's fine. Otherwise, we wouldn't eat it.
Well, I want some Slavic bacon.
Slaken.
Yeah. If it tasted shit, they wouldn't eat it. So it must taste all right, whatever they eat, you know.
All right. So you are at the cafe, and you have pretty much eaten your breakfast and sipped your coffee and tea. And what are your plans for the day?
What do you reckon, chaps? Well, if we go to a cement factory, like I keep suggesting, what are we actually going to ask them? I'm a bit puzzled about that.
Me too.
Oh, yeah, that was Dr. Keefe's idea, actually.
Yeah. But very, you know, I can't think of any other lead to go on, to be honest. And I must admit, a bit last night has thrown me a bit on the edge, to be honest. I wasn't expecting that.
Did you get a look at that thing, Dr. Dawkins?
Yeah, that's what I mean. We were questioned by the police, so we never had a chance to do that.
Well, you got a pretty good look at it, Dr. Dawkins.
But I mean, I wanted to study it more or less, you know.
I'm just wanted to confirm that what you were saying, did I hear that right? That like it wasn't like stitched together or anything like that? They were actually like.
It looked like it was a. An animal, like an animal that's been born that way.
Wow. Not like Frankenstein's monster from that book.
Right.
Shelley book. You can see the stitches and stuff, couldn't you?
I didn't make one, but there would most definitely be a big, gigantic article in the morning's paper about a monster found, but no photograph.
Good. What do we do?
So the cement factory, as I understood it, was if you're looking to destroy the knife. Is that what you guys were getting out of it?
I think it's what Dr. Keefe was getting at, yes. It would have the facilities to destroy the knife, if that was your objection. But if anyone has gone and destroyed the knife there, I guess all the evidence is going to be long gone anyway, isn't it?
Yeah.
As I mean, you know, I don't mind going there. It's just a fact of... can't think of what I'm actually going to ask them if I actually can get there.
Unless we just go...
Unless we try to find the young lady that you saw in the car before breakfast. Unless we look around, do a bit of recon and see if we can track her down.
I want to find a cult member.
We haven't got any clues to a location for the cult, have we? Even though there must be one nearby from this creature.
Yeah. Well, we could go to the cement factory just to at least check it out, like if something seems fishy or odd about it, but I can't imagine it would, but we could at least... If we knew where it was, you know what I mean? Like, if we had to get there in a hurry or something, we could...
It's only a mile outside of town.
That's easy enough to hire.
You could walk there in 20 minutes.
Might even be a bus there or something.
Yeah. Well, that or take a taxi. You've been using taxis all the time, so... And if we need a quick getaway, that would be good.
Yeah, just a good point. I'll get a taxi.
Well, the other thing I could think of is we go back and see if we could find the doctor. See if he knows anything more about Dragomir's disappearance and the shotgun.
We can try.
But he's a hard man to get a hold of.
Maybe we should make a bit more effort, if you know what I mean. So he hasn't got no choice but meet us.
Tom, do we know what his particular skills are as a doctor?
He's a rather accomplished surgeon. And most of, you know, in the he probably had a rather rather mundane career in the beginning, but at a certain point he began devoting all of his time to helping helping victims of the war, trying to make their lives better.
Sounds like a good chap.
And he does a lot of research, obviously, too. Because the he's looking for new ways of doing things.
What if he's such an accomplished surgeon that he could have stitched that those pieces together without scar
tissue? That's a really good and a really creepy point as well.
Yeah. I don't know what freaks me out more, the fact that there is no seam or if there was a seam.
Well, the fact if it is him that made it, he's got the ability to do such a thing.
That's true. Yeah.
I mean, we need to see some of the people maybe he's treated. Maybe if we do a visit to the hospital and have a look around the wall. Oh, that's difficult to tell, isn't it? I mean, how are we going to gain access to him?
Yeah.
Maybe that's why he's trying to avoid us.
Perhaps.
He doesn't want to talk to us, maybe.
Well, the cement factory's nearby. Do you guys want to just do that?
Yeah, we go to the cement factory.
Yeah, just to know what we're going to ask them.
Yeah.
Not there.
Or we don't have to confront them necessarily, but see what we see.
All right. It's not far. The taxi can drop you off. It's the
Ask the taxi driver to wait for us as well.
The Bolotovich Cement Factory. This time of the morning, it's already up and running. It's going full blast. It's not a huge factory. Because there are no huge factories like that, but they're producing cement. They obviously have trucks coming in with rock, which goes into a machine that conveyor belts them into a rock crusher that crushes it all up. And when you arrive, there's not really any security. You just have to sort of wander onto the property and find somebody who looks like they're in charge, I guess.
Which we'd probably be doing, because we don't really know. Yeah, like I say, we're looking about, not really sure what we're looking for.
You definitely pass a few people who are working, and they look at you, and they don't. They look like they're debating whether they should keep working or that they should ask you who the hell you are. But they keep working. Eventually, somebody who looks like a foreman sees you and comes up, and he's speaking in Croatian. You'll see, you have Eldritch with you, okay? And basically, the translation is he's like, "Hey, who the hell are you people? What are you doing here? This isn't like a tourist area."
What is this place?
And he's like, "It's a cement factory. We make cement here. Haven't you ever seen a cement factory before?"
Not in Croatia or Vinkovici, wherever we are.
Oh, well, then let me show you around. Okay, I don't know if it's that way in Vinkovici, but it was that way in Greece when we'd walk into places.
Really?
I walked into a place and this archaeologist comes out and he's like, "Hey, you can't be in here. You can't be in here." And we're like, "We just wanted to look around." And he goes, "Okay, I'll show you around." And he showed us all over the place. It's amazing. All right. So he kind of takes you on a tour of this this cement factory. And there's not much more to it than that. There's different constituent parts of cement that all get eventually mixed together, but there is definitely a big old rock crusher Okay, which I don't know what that amounts to. A couple of gigantic steel drums that run together and crush rock. And the rock gets progressively smaller and smaller and smaller. All right. I would like you all to do spot hiddens.
No, I didn't get it.
What'd you get, Dr. Buck?
39.
What did you get, Jeff?
Sorry, Doctor, I got a 15.
You got a 15?
Oh.
All right.
Jeff.
I'm sorry, Simon, you got a what, 17?
79.
Oh, 79, okay.
Yeah.
Well, it's Simon, Rupert notices that there's a lot of frickin' noise and a lot of dust. And he doesn't really care for it because, you know, it's noisy and it's dusty. Dr. Dawkins, you notice two things. One is there are large, in order to get this whole thing to keep running smoothly, there are large quantities of a kind of a blackish gray grease, similar to stains that you saw on Morik's clothing. There's also a lot of dust, a lot of white powder, and it you thought at first it was dirt, but it wasn't dirt. It was cement powder that was probably on Dr. Morik's clothes.
Okay.
Jeff, Frank, you notice that very near the rock crusher, there are stains on the floor and there are stains on part of the machine and part of the wall that's right there. They're dark, but they look like they may have been blood splatters. Now, the place is not clean, so it's not something that the average person wouldn't think, oh, it's just a splatter of grease or something else. Mm-hmm. But this definitely looks like it was blood at one point.
Hmm. Yeah, if everything's dust covered, then I would imagine blood might stand out a little bit.
Yeah, it's dark. Yeah, you can see, and it looks like places where there was blood here on the ground, a poodle of blood and some splatters. And
I probably don't notice anything because I'm having to sneeze and fit into my handkerchief or something.
Yeah.
I will say, since we are being taken by this, I guess, foreman.
Yeah. And he seems completely, you know, oblivious if you want to ask him any questions.
Yeah, but I'll say to you guys, remember that time in the cave? In the last place that we were at?
What, the ambush attempt?
Well, I wasn't trying to be all open with that, but I was going to say just...
He doesn't speak English.
Oh, well, I don't know that. I mean, I know he speaks a different language, but I'm not sure.
But do you think it might happen here?
I'm just saying, just be on guard.
Okay, I will be. I look a lot more alert than I was before, with my hand in my pocket. What are we looking for then?
If there's an opportunity to point the blood out to these guys, I will, like, without making a big deal or fuss about it.
All right. Yeah, you guys know that you're looking for something, so. All you have to do is kind of point at it, and they see it and realize it.
I'm trying to distract the guide a little bit to get him to explain something about the factory to me so the doctor can get a better look at the blood splat, because he obviously going to have better knowledge of me about this sort of thing.
All right.
So I'll play dumb tourist for a while.
Yeah, he basically tells you and Eldridge that, you know, the rock crusher can... It exerts, 150 tons of pressure on the rocks to crush them. And
bloody marvelous, isn't it?
Yeah.
Absolutely bloody marvelous. Fantastic. And you say it goes into earth, does it? Amazing. Yeah,
and then this mixes here, and this mixes with that, and
I just say
cement, and it goes into packages, and we ship the packages.
Topo, absolutely spiffing.
While he's doing that, I will take a closer look at the blood splatter in that particular area.
It's definitely recent, and it's definitely blood.
I remember you telling us when we found his body in the woods that it seemed like he was lacking blood, which we pieced together that he was murdered somewhere else.
A shotgun could go off here and nobody would hear it.
Well, I remember he was shot in the back with like a small caliber gun.
If you're going to shoot somebody, there's enough racket here to cover it up.
Wondering, does the blood here, like the amount, kind of match with?
Yes, your guess is that this is where he was shot.
Okay.
I'm going to
turn to the guy and say, where do you put bodies?
Well, here's the thing. You guys have not made it completely. There's workers around. You're not alone where you're standing. People have seen you looking at stuff. Nobody cares.
Yeah, it's cool.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
You get the impression that none of these workers, including the foreman, have anything to do with anything.
But less you know, the better.
You also know that this place is completely deserted at night, and there's no guards. There's no security.
All right.
I'm going to, while I'm in this area where the blood splatter is, I'm going to look or try to find if there's any sort of bone fragments or brain fragments.
Or gun cartridge.
None. It none looks like it's just blood. No, as far as him getting his head blown off, that was done by the shotgun in the woods.
Okay.
But yeah, he'd already lost a tremendous amount of blood before he got there, yeah.
Well, yeah, it was because I remember being in the woods and asking if there was any bone fragments of brain matter, and you said no, so I was just wondering.
I thought I said that it's all over the place.
So if he came here to just... blood.
Okay.
He came here to destroy the dagger, and then he failed to destroy the dagger, and they shot him, which means they now probably have the dagger. Because the dagger's missing, isn't it? He didn't have it on him.
Yeah.
Keith came up with the idea of this being a great place to come to destroy it. It looks like somebody else had the same idea. Shot him, if with which case they got the dagger and they put the body in the forest.
Yeah, very possible.
Unless the dagger's laying around in the forest that we didn't see. But I should imagine that's when they killed him. They knew he had the dagger. They killed him and took it. Unless he stashed it around here before. If we can look about unexpected easy access hiding holes, we might find his stash somewhere if he knew he was being followed.
Can I ask the foreman, like, what's involved to run this giant machine? Is it, do you need a key to start it, or is it
He says basically that that they turn the power supply off at night. It's a big, thing, chung. And then all that you have to do to start the machine is a big button over here, big red button.
I'm looking around on things like ledges or things, somewhere where somebody might have slipped something to out of sight that would be too difficult to find.
Go ahead and do a spot hidden.
That's 56. No, I fail.
Okay, you don't find anything.
I'm quite happy to look around there.
It's just that I realize that If you had gotten a one or a two, I would have still said you didn't fuck.
Yeah. Oh, well.
Although now you don't know.
What should we do, chaps?
Well, I say we leave for the time being.
Maybe come back later, you mean?
Yeah.
Yeah, Dr. Keith might want to come personally check it out, too.
Right. Anywhere we think of going from here, or should we go back to the hotel? Because the thing is, that policeman wasn't very happy about the fact we weren't in the hotel. Yeah, or the lodge, should we say. So basically, I think we're going to have to be careful about traveling about, because if he catches us out and about too much, he's not going to be very happy. Mind you, what does he expect from a bloody tourist? I mean, what's quite a bit of tourist if you can stay in your hotel room all the bloody time? Can't even buy a postcard.
So you're going to return to the hotel?
Yeah.
All right.
So, okay. So if he had, let's assume he found a dagger at the dig site. He didn't put it in the crate with all the other artifacts.
But from what we could see.
He was aware of how to destroy it with the cement factory.
Was there a case for it, but the knife wasn't in the case, or am I mistaken?
Yeah, I think that's what we assumed, that little
That's how we knew there was a knife involved, because we found the case, but the knife wasn't in the case, which indicates he found it.
Yeah.
And if he read the notes he found at the site, he might have realized this is the knife that the Crusaders came across. He's got the same reference we have.
But if you were an archaeologist, do you think he would be willing to destroy an artifact like that?
If he knows about the evil it contains, if he's researched the occult, or he knows, like he might have came across a passage in the book which could tell him as much as we know about it. I mean, but for again, if you're going to destroy that, why not destroy the Judas coin?
Right.
If you're going to destroy one item of evil, but not the other.
Right.
Because I can't imagine the Judas's coin being an item of good. Yeah, I think it could only usually be used for evil purposes. But why get rid of the dagger, but not the coin?
Mm-hmm.
Unless he knew better after the dagger.
And if he was carrying it around with him for some reason, then we know that they've probably got him.
In fact, the ones that killed him, they searched the body and they would come across it. And that's probably the reason that they were hunting him in the first place, because they knew he had it somehow.
Right.
They seem to have some sort of occult way of gaining information.
Yeah.
Some form of scrying, which I always thought was a load of rubbish when I looked into the occult, but you live and learn. Because they seem to be keeping up with us no matter what we do. Admittedly, we're keeping to a train tack, but we're not necessarily keeping to a timetable.
Mm-hmm.
But they do seem to be keeping up with us rather well. They seem to have no trouble attacking and finding us to attack. Which means they must be using not just human methods to spy on us.
Mm-hmm.
Well, he's using supernatural things to attack us. Why not use supernatural forces to spy on us?
Yeah.
Which means we're always going to be at a disadvantage, because we're never going to know when it's coming. But they will probably know when we're coming.
Not to mention, they're using these creatures. It seems like they were coming after us.
Well, we're obviously a threat to them, and they're obviously scared about us. I mean, to use something as valuable as that in an assassination attempt either means you haven't got the manpower or the ability to do it yourself, or they were overly confident in what they were doing. But whatever the result is, they're taking us very, very seriously. And they're very scared of us, which means we're doing the right thing. Mm-hmm. I'd give anything to find out when their headquarters was and pay them another visit. Now we've got to try and do an investigation, but we've also got to worry about the police finding the set.
Yeah. They're not making it easy.
Maybe I should get some more money at the bank for bribery purposes. Bail money.
I like the bumbling tourist plan too.
Oh, well, that's what we are, really, isn't it? I mean, if it would, I mean, to anyone, everyone else on the train is, aren't they? Mm-hmm. The more I think I'm just an upper-class oike without a clue of what he's doing, the more benefit it is to us to go to places without really being seen as a threat. There's not a big place over this town.
No, not huge.
So therefore, if they have got a headquarters here, we might be able to dig it up with a little bit of investigation. We've been pretty good at that in the past. Let's wander around a bit and see if fate delivers us anything for us. You know, admittedly, it's not very warm outside, so there can't be that many people wandering about, but we might find a lead like we did last time. We're not going to find out much sitting here. Mm-hmm. Let's go out and have a wander about, and let's be tourists. Let's go out and buy some postcards. Have a walk around this place and try and find somewhere it looks like it could contain skinning coal. They may even have a sign up.
Have a sign up.
Skinning coal, apply within.
That sign looks like a man, except he has no skin.
My dad said he knows somebody that joined that.
That bar over there is called We Are the Skinning Cult Bar.
Next door to the pork pie shop.
All right. How many hours are you going to spend walking around doing nothing?
2 or 3 hours, because we haven't really got much of a direction. We haven't figured out what direction to go in yet. So just wander about, look at, hopefully stumbling on fate rather than anything else. I mean, last time we found their headquarters.
Why don't you do an idea roll, because as far as fate goes, you got a 98.
I got an 11.
33 out of 70. Okay. So that's a hard, not hard, but
I sent you a note in the chat. It's just basically you have all the clues. I suggest as investigators, you just go over all the things that you've got so far.
Yeah, that's kind of reading through some of that.
Well, feel free to read things out loud, because sometimes when you read them out loud.
Players. I don't know if this is much of a clue or not, but it might be. In that newspaper article about the Cuda Vista, it talked about a Mr. Svenka, who was the only witness. Mm-hmm. He was a terrified plumber.
Does it say the district the attack happened in?
Actually, if you pin that down, he lives practically across the street from the hotel. So he probably saw the thing on your hotel that night.
Oh, okay.
He might have, if he did, he might have seen roughly where it came from. If you got something like that as a pet, you're going to keep it close to home and not take it out too much unless you have to. See if we can track this gentleman down. Like I say, it's not a big town. Even ask at the lodge staff if any of them know them. They're all locals as well. They might have, a local connection.
I'll give it to you that in your 2 or 3 hours wandering around, you find the guy and ask him, and he just looked out of his window and saw it on your building.
He didn't see where it came from.
He didn't see where it came or where it went.
Thank you for your time, sir. It's much appreciated. Damn. What else we got?
Notebook.
What else we got, Frank? The notebook.
Did I send you a copy of the notebook?
Yep, I'm looking at that one.
Okay.
I think the only thing I didn't have was the original newspaper article.
That's right.
Yeah. But you've read it a couple times, but.
Yeah.
Just kind of skimming through it. Most dangerous item in the collection is a serpent's claw. Nims the ace. Evil satanic powers. First account was recorded in the 4th century by troops serving Constantine the Great. See the accounts of Tilius Corvus.
Mm-hmm.
Is that a book?
It's one of the books that you got.
We have that book.
Yeah.
Yeah. I was hoping to dive into a couple of those books and read them when the train journey starts again. If anything like a Crusader book, it was a damn good read.
They seem to believe it could be destroyed if ground to dust, but that no such power existed in their time.
Hence the concrete factory.
Yep.
Like Heath said. She's a bloodhound, isn't she?
We'll talk to Goran later and inspect Bolotovic's cement factory. Goran was, right? He was the cement factory guy?
Goran is Dr. Bellinzada.
That's right.
That's his first name.
He's the one that's been avoiding us, isn't he?
What makes you think he's been avoiding you?
I don't know. Isn't he just the guy? I'm not trying to place who he is.
Well,
it's the father of the person I got the photograph of, isn't he? Probably.
No.
Has she got the last name?
No, Dr. Bellinzada, the surgeon who's helping people.
The one we suspect might be.
I explained last time that he has a very set schedule.
Yeah.
That he has breakfast, then he goes to the hospital, then he goes to his research lab, and then around midnight he comes home and goes to bed.
Yeah. Yeah, we were kind of reading into that, I think, a little too much. We probably just didn't
catch. Yeah, you just happened to be in the wrong place at the wrong time.
Yeah.
Which is the dynamic of the game. It was meant to decide. I had to decide what time it was.
If we knew where he lives, we could always wait around his home and hope he isn't too freaked out the fact that we're waiting around midnight, so to speak. He may speak to us.
Well, he's spoken to you once.
Jasmina, if you're reading this, make sure everything here goes to Dr. R. Giordanov, Director of Ancient History at the National Archaeological Museum in Sofia, Bulgaria.
Let's interject this in here, that's what she intends on doing, except with those books which you have decided you want to look through, and she's asked you to deliver them to him when you arrive. Everything else will be shipped there. When you get to Sofia, Bulgaria, which is on your route. It's not next on your route, but...
Yeah. We took the coin, right?
What about the letter to her that we first came across, the cryptic letter that was in English?
Mm-hmm.
Over that again, because... it's amongst the clues, and he might have been cryptic in that. Because it took us ages to find out something.
Go to Puzdan Zahila, use your mother's maiden name. Key submerged in a nearby river bath. I think we did all that pretty much.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So maybe before that.
Are you referring to this one? Hold on.
This site is very unusual. I'm sure the structure isn't a tomb. I've learned some things about the Order of the Noble Shield and their history. Most of it should not be made public. Details of the excavation, including photographs of the site, were leaked to the local press. The story was meant as an attack against my character, but now I fear for the security of the find. There are various documents and artifacts which would be quite valuable to an unscrupulous collector. I'm sorry for being vague, but I dare not write more in case this letter is intercepted. I don't know who to trust. Someone on my team is likely working against me. I need you to come to the Vinkovitsky at once. I'll be waiting for you at the hotel.
Lerner.
Don't tell anybody that you're coming. If I'm not there, I'll leave a message for you at the front desk. Once you get to town, speak to nobody. Go directly to the hotel. I'll explain everything in person. Hopefully, I have most of it sorted out by the time you arrive. I hate to possibly put you in danger, and I don't know who else I can trust. Please bring my service revolver and a box of ammunition. I'll keep in my study. They're next to my favorite book. You should remember the one I mean, Father. Did we go to his study?
His study is in Zagreb.
Zagreb, yeah.
No, both of those end things were meant as a clue to the bookstore on
that
one street.
Which we did, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
In which case,
what? You found the note inside the book.
Maybe we should pay more attention to the books in our possession. If he learned what it was from that, maybe we should.
Yeah, the books that we have already in our possession, you mean?
Yeah. Well, we've only surface skimmed them, haven't we?
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, it's going to take a while to read it.
Yes, about 6 months.
Mm.
Except for Tullius Corvus, but you're going to do that on the train.
Yeah.
When you finish this one.
I'm totally at a loss.
Yeah.
What other clues have we got?
All right, do an idea roll rather than
yep.
Sit around wondering.
No, 99.
90.
Frank News, 23.
Ah, good Jeff. Good Frank. In Dr. Morick's notebook, at the end, we'll talk to Gorin later and inspect Boltovich cement factory.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. We'll Gorin knew Gorin. Where he was going. Gorin knew he was going to the cement factory.
And he talked to him about something. Obviously, this stuff.
So if anybody was going to go to the cement factory to stop him, it would probably be Gorin. Don't you think?
Yeah, I keep flip-flopping on him. I can't. One minute I trust him, and one minute I don't. Talk to Gorin later and inspect.
Excuse me for a second.
What's your take on him, Dawkins? Do you trust him?
I don't trust anybody here. But that's just me being paranoid.
You're the one keeping us alive.
What is that noise?
It's probably my fan.
Sounds like a rattlesnake.
Oh, well, that's not my fan then.
Oh, that might be me. I got a new toy and it's addictive.
Uh-oh.
It's called a fidget spinner.
Yeah.
With my headphones, I can't hear it. Sometimes it hits paper.
Yeah. like that. Yeah.
Huh. Yeah. I think we need to find the conductor. We also have his niece. She didn't seem to know a whole lot, but. So I guess we could try to track the doctor down and just ask him if he spoke to Dragomir and see if maybe he passed on information. That...
Did the news of the murder, of Dragomir's murder, did it get into the papers at all?
Barely. Basically, it's saying that a possible suspect in the People's Justice Army, Dragomir Morik, was murdered, probably by cohorts in the terrorist group. He's a Croat. They're Serbs.
We're under the impression that Goran was his friend, though, right?
Yes, they've been friends. Jasmine has said they've been friends since the war.
Yeah.
Close friends.
So do you think we need to go have another word with Goran?
I think so. What time of day is it?
Let's say about, you guys have been walking around for hours. You went to the cement factory. I'd say it's probably about 2 o'clock in the afternoon.
So he should be at the hospital.
He won't be home till midnight, would he?
Well, let's stop at the hospital, let's check, and then we can talk to him. If he's not there, we can check at his residence. And if he's not there, we'll think of something.
Agreed. Okay. Agreed. We shall set off.
Yep.
All right. This only takes you about an hour, but you discover that he is not at the hospital. And some of the staff are rather concerned because he hasn't showed up for a couple of days now.
We'd better do his home.
You check at his home, and his niece also says that he hasn't been there for a couple of days.
Oh boy!
No. Based on your understanding of things, the last time anybody saw him was the day that you guys spoke to him at breakfast.
Oh dear!
So sometime during that day. Now, his niece does say that he has an apartment at his research facility.
Ah, can you write that down on a piece of paper for me?
Well, you've already been there.
Have we not? That's what we saw him, is it? Check it out. We've got nothing to lose.
We didn't go in, right? We just went there.
You didn't.
And saw the, was it closed? I can't remember.
No, you got there and there was a guard who was obviously an army vet because he was like missing an eye and he was missing an arm.
Yeah.
And he called inside, and that's when the doctor told him to just have you guys meet him for breakfast at his home the next morning.
What should we do? Try and pretend we've got an appointment?
Yeah.
Try that approach. So I guess a taxi there, and
yeah. If
he tries to stop us, we do have an appointment. He asks us to come and see him today at this time.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So,
do you want a fast talk or some charm or something like that?
Let's see. All right. So you get in your cab, you drive to the research facility. If I were to describe the research facility, I described it once before, but I'll do it again.
Mm-hmm.
There's a 6 foot high block wall that runs all the way around the facility. There's a number of buildings inside. There is a barbed wire on the top of the facility, and there's a gate. The gate is on my directions are going out the window. On the east side of the complex. That's where you're approaching it from. And you can see that there are maybe 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 buildings, the fifth one being 2 stories tall.
Right.
They're not ultra modern. It looks like they may have been built back during maybe World War I, and they've been converted into this research facility. You can see there is a man at the front gate.
I'm going to get a taxi to park not quite near the gate. So when I approach the gate, he can see I've definitely got a limp.
Okay, that's a good idea. All right. Let's see how we do this. All right. So you're actually parking.
Good man.
You're actually parking a little ways away, and then you're going to walk up. You're all going to walk up together. Let's say Eldritch is with you.
Yeah, he could probably take my elbow and help me a bit because I'm
not sure. But Dr. Elizabeth wanted to stay. Dr. Elizabeth wanted to stay back.
I think she has a flu or a bad cold.
Well, she's also making sure that nobody touches your stuff.
Hello, old chap. Got an appointment.
Hold on.
Sorry.
I would like Rupert to do a spot hidden.
Oh, no.
You're still about 50 feet away from the gate.
No way. Didn't make it.
Okay.
He never makes it.
You're now about 30 feet away from the gate. I'd like Frank and Dr. Dawkins to do a spot hidden.
Ooh. I made it by 1.
I didn't make it.
All right, so Frank, you guys are all walking towards the gate.
Mm-hmm.
When suddenly Frank reaches out a hand and sort of puts it on you, Rupert, just like he's obviously seen something.
So much old chap.
Frank, what you notice is, first off, that's the same guard that was there the other day.
Okay.
But he's dressed a little nicer, like in a, you know, he's dressed up more in a suit than he was before. And he has 2 eyes and 2 arms. And one of those arms looks kind of black and hairy. What?
Do we really want to go in here?
We've got complex has given me the creep since day one.
We're going to have to go in. Just pretend we don't notice ourselves, I imagine.
He at this point now he sees you coming towards him. And he doesn't he's just standing there waiting for you to approach.
Good morning, old man. Got an appointment.
He looks at his thing and he says, I don't see any appointments.
You remember us coming from the other day?
Yes, you were here the other day.
We contacted him and they told us to come back here at this time.
He hasn't said anything to me, but then he's very busy with his research right now.
Yeah, I know, but I've flown all the way from England to see him. This doctor's been highly recommended to help me with my war injuries. I was hoping to get a quick word with him. I've come such a long way. Nothing you can do for a fellow veteran, is it?
He says, give me a moment. I'll make a phone call.
I much appreciate it, old chap.
All right.
I've come a very long way.
As he turns to do that, I would like you once again to all do a spot hidden roll.
Nope. I walk into the jaws of death and wouldn't even know it.
Nope.
Jeff?
88.
Jeff?
Yes.
All right. Jeff, as you're standing there once again, this time you put your hand on Dr. Dawkins.
Did you see that?
What you see is at first, as you're standing there and the guard is now in there and you're looking in at the complex, you think at first that you see a guard dog come around a corner over there, like a big German Shepherd. Except that that German Shepherd, it has like the head of a gorilla.
Of course,
and it has. And its back half looks a little more like a jaguar or an animal, a cat of some sort.
I'm so happy I found my spot here.
I think you need to do a sanity roll.
Sure. 45 out of 50. So pass.
All right. We'll take at least a couple of sanity points because you suddenly realize not only have you seen something incredibly bizarre, but at this moment in time, you might be in extreme danger.
Yes, I think if we haven't got the appointment written down, we can't force the man to say, maybe we should come back another time. I said to my companions.
Okay.
I mean, what's this guardhouse guy doing? Is he trying to sort it for us? I mean, don't try too hard. I mean, I don't want you to get you into trouble.
The guard says, yes, I understand. And he turns around and he says, please come inside.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I should go. Oh, dear. I don't know if you guys want to wait outside
for me. No. Take care, Rupert. It's, you know.
I'll help you in, Rupert.
Thank you, old boy. Yeah, much appreciated.
I'm going to.
Just for my pride, I don't like asking.
He closes the gate behind you.
Don't tell me he locks it.
Boy, Thomas and Mick are going to be surprised when they're the only people playing it.
We're all playing your manservants.
Holy shit.
I mean, of look, I tell you what, if the appointment's not in the book, I don't want you to get into trouble. He's obviously a busy man. What I'll do is come back the same time tomorrow.
No, please, it's no problem. Come with us. Come with me.
I really don't want to be a pain.
He's now walking you.
I'm feeling better. Oh, I think I'm in recovery.
It's America.
Okay, well, let me give you some information. As you walk in the gate, okay, the gate is, as I said, on the east side of the complex. It's also, it's really kind of in the northeast corner, okay? Directly ahead of you, there is a building. And to your left, there is a much larger building. Now, from the much larger building, it's a very rectangular sort of building, you can hear animal noises. Various unusual sounding animal noises. Is that a lion? Is that a chimpanzee sound? Is that a bird? You know, you can hear something, and the building strikes you as it's probably like a kennel. Okay. Just beyond, now you're walking towards this other building, not that building. You're walking towards another building. There is a two-story building behind that one, and then one farther on. But he takes you to this first building.
Are there any cars in this area?
There are a couple cars parked outside, probably from the employees.
Or like within the gated area, right?
Yes. Yeah. No, they're out. They're outside.
Actually. They're outside the gate.
Yeah.
Okay.
Just as you get to this first building, another man comes out, and this man Let me find him. This man is this man was obviously also an amputee, no longer. You can see that he has been fixed with animal parts in the same way this first guy has been fixed with animal parts. You now realize, as he's about to usher you into this first building, that this is the guardhouse.
Right. I sort of whisper to my companion, shall we make a break for it now? For the gates.
How what do we say? How is the gate open and closed? Is it mechanical?
It's just, you could put a big lock on it, but at the moment it's not locked. You know, it's just a gate. Okay, just as he opens the door, this other guy is stepped out, and just as he steps out, another thing comes out of the building behind him, and at first your mind reels to try to figure out what the fuck you're looking at, but you want to think it's a big dog because things that size are big dogs, but in this case it's part big dog and part ram, and its head is definitely like a black bear. It's another monster. And you also at this point realize that he's about to lock you guys up.
Let's try and make a breakthrough while we're here.
I think you're right.
Yep.
Okay, I'm gonna swing a punch at the guardsman or whatever it is. Try and get him a punch so we can shut.
I forgot to pay the taxi driver. Let's go.
All right, just a moment. Let me grab their stats.
Try and get away, but if he tries to stop us, I'd have to punch him.
Well, he is definitely going to try to stop you. All right. Let's go ahead and do our... I'm going to give you the initiative because you decided you were going to do it.
Is he armed?
Not with a gun, no. Okay. All right, go ahead and you're going to try to punch him.
Yeah.
He's not prepared, so.
26 and out of 55, so I believe it's a hard success almost.
All right, so you haul off and punch him right in the head, and as you do, he falls. But immediately the other guy... he looks down at the guy and then he immediately reacts by coming at you. And what he does is he pulls out like a baton. Right. However, he pulls out a baton and he definitely has like a chimpanzee arm.
Of course. I'm going to rely on my companion's actions to save me here. Unless I could dodge.
The bear thing is also going to become...
I'm gonna try and get me down out.
And find and start attacking. So how about the other two people? What are you guys gonna do?
I'm gonna try to clock him over the head with my cane. And right after that I'll ready my cane. Well, I'll pull out the sword portion of the cane.
Okay. So you're gonna hit him with the cane first?
Yeah.
All right, go ahead and do that roll.
You're hitting the first guy or the second guy?
The second guy, probably. The other guy went down. I mean, he fell.
He's down. Okay.
He wasn't expecting to get hit.
Yeah, that was an 09.
All right. Well,
nicely done.
All right. You clock him on the side of his head with your cane, which knocks him, at least it partially knocks him down. Frank, what are you going to do? Now the Cuda Vista is going to attack you.
Guess I'm going to pull out my revolver. shot. Nope, 54, miss.
All right. You shoot right past it, and it lunges at you. But it's clumsy, so it doesn't quite... You find it rather easy to jump out of the way.
Okay.
All right. First guy is starting to recover, and interestingly enough, he is rather agile with his modified body parts.
Mm-hmm.
So, but he has to recover, so he's got one round he's recovering.
I'll punch him again then.
Okay, go ahead, try.
I fail, 70.
Okay, and he got an 82, so he wouldn't have dodged it anyway, but all right, so you swing at him, but he's rolling on the ground. And by now he's up, okay? So the second guy is also very agile and begins to move towards Dr. Dawkins.
I draw my blade.
Okay.
From the cane.
All right.
Well, since these guys are attacking and it looks like they're doing it to kill, I will try to thrust them with my blade. And that is a 29 out of 25, so I fail.
Spend some luck.
Okay.
I can't get combat.
He got a 27, which means that he effectively dodged your thrust anyway.
Okay.
All right. Cuda Vista is now lunging once again at you, Frank.
Okay.
Oh, I forget that Eldridge is here too, isn't he?
Whether he likes it or not.
All right. We'll deal with Eldridge in a moment.
See if we get out alive. If we don't get out alive, say he wasn't with us. So the campaign can carry on.
Can I still shoot again?
Sure.
I'll also try yelling, like if it were part bear, like, you know, trying to scare a bear away, like, go on, get. Then again, gunshot would probably scare it. Nope, missed it by 10.
Okay. So once again, you're so unnerved by this bizarre thing. Actually, I think at this point, everybody needs to do a sanity roll because you've realized these are, you realize two things. One is they've been enhanced with body parts, or rather fixed with body parts, but they're still men, except for that thing.
I make
it. I fell my sanity roll by 1.
52 out of 63.
Okay. Well, if you failed it, roll a 1d4. If you didn't, just take 2 damage.
That put me down.
Failed with a 93.
Okay. The feline dog thing that you saw earlier has now come and attacked Eldridge, so they're fighting. It's got claws, so.
It took 4 sanity.
I would like you all three to do a luck roll, and if one of you gets a extreme luck.
13 out of 42.
Oh,
I got a 20 out of 45, so that's not really an extreme.
Hard.
I went from a 93 to an 01.
You got an 01.
I got an 01.
Oh, you beautiful person.
All right. All of a sudden, now, you guys are struggling. You guys are terrified. You guys are fighting with these things. But in the back of your head, you hear a noise. And what that noise is it sounds like people. And what you realize is that somehow, some way, the police have put together a few things, and they have arrived.
They
probably think that this is has something to do with the People's Justice Army, whatever.
We're here.
But they've suddenly broken in. I mean, they've bashed open the gate, and a number of officers are running in, and as soon as they run in, there are actually more coup de vistas, two others that come from around farther around the buildings and start running at the police officers. When they see them, a whole fight breaks out. Okay, so there is now a lot of commotion going on.
I think what we should do is use the chaos to try and get to this Gorham and see, try and deal with him firsthand before the police get to him. If the police get to him, get hold of him, we can. If we get hold of him before the police do, we might be able to grab hold of the dagger.
However, if we get to him and we corner him and the police come in on us, he might be able to say, hey, these guys attacked me, or these guys are the terrorists.
We'll take that risk. We're here anyway. I don't think we're going to get to the gates.
Here's a question for the GM. Did the police see us? Or were they too busy?
All they've seen is a lot of people, and they've just automatically thought this must be the place where something fishy is going on, because that thing that we've got back at the precinct, and they came here maybe to ask questions, and they saw
more of these things.
So, but they're at the same time, they're kind of terrified. So it's just like a crazy battle is going on. And yes, it would make a perfect distraction at this point that they're all going to be.
We might as well use the chance to our advantage. If it doesn't work out, it doesn't work out. But
now,
I think we should press on.
Go ahead. This is a different kind of spot hidden, but go ahead and do a spot hidden.
Mind it. Oh, no, hang on. That's 37. Yeah, I'll find it.
Pass for me.
Okay, Frank. The building behind this looks like an apartment. The building behind that, the big building towards the back of the facility, looks like that might be a laboratory.
The two-story one?
No, the two-story one is like an apartment. It's like an office in an apartment.
I see Frank's gaze and where he starts heading, and I immediately follow him.
Well, I'm not entirely convinced I'm going in, because I'm
going
on the edge of sanity loss.
I'll go in. I'm sick to death of this person treating us like this. Total bad manners.
All right.
I'll go in. I'll give him a damn good thrashing.
But what about the things we're dealing with?
All right. Like the police have caught up to you, and now the whole battle seems to be in their hands.
Okay.
They're all distracted. You guys can actually make the move.
Yeah, press on. We haven't got much time on our hands, so go as quickly as we can.
All right. Well, if we're going to do it, let's do it now.
All right. So you run back to the medical facility that's there.
Got my gun drawn now.
What's that?
I got my gun drawn now.
Okay. And it's not locked. There's obviously power here. Noises of like refrigerators and places like that. And when you first break in, or when you first walk inside, you're obviously in part of a medical facility, and through a couple of double doors, it's definitely a lab. Now, right. Dr. Bellinzada is here in the lab, but let me describe what you're seeing.
Right.
There are at least three large metal tables in the center of the room. On one of them, it looks like there are at least two human bodies, probably cadavers, that have been partially dissected and body parts removed. There are animals of different kinds. It looks like there's a gorilla, a pig, maybe even something as bizarre as a kangaroo that are on the other table. They've all been partially taken apart and cut to pieces, taken apart. All of them are twitching.
Oh, okay. Sanity roll.
But we'll do the sanity roll afterwards. On the third table, where Dr. Bellanzada is standing, he has created some sort of thing with monstrous teeth and jaws and long, long claws and strange tentacle sort of body parts, and it's a monstrosity, and it's also twitching, and he's standing over it working on it, and as you burst into the room, he yells at you. He's like, "Get out of here! I'm busy doing my research. Go away! I don't want you here," like this. And you see that in his hand, he holds a very strange looking sort of knife. It seems to be that the handle itself is made out of bone because it's kind of off-white. And there is a long, black, curved blade, almost like it's made out of obsidian. And the whole thing sort of glows, kind of purple in the light as he's holding it.
That's it, chaps. That's it. Oh, dear.
What do you do?
You want to shoot at him first, or should I?
Now, he hasn't made any violent moves towards you.
You could get Alfred. I mean, I'm slowest out of all of us, so you lot would beat me to him. If you deal with him, I try and deal with the creatures.
Drop the knife and step away from the table.
He's like, get out of here. Go. Get. He says, I'm far too busy.
Do we need sanity roll because of all the atrocities?
Well, we'll get to that in a minute. At the moment, your adrenaline is too high.
Oh, cool. Get him.
I pointed at him. Drop the knife, or this will be the last experiment you ever perform.
He's like, you don't understand the necessity for this kind of work. We're trying to cure people. We're trying to fix them from their problems, and you're just interrupting my research.
Actually, we came to help. Just put down the knife and let us help you. I mean, you might be having some sort of block.
I definitely he's going to listen to you.
So why are you here anyway? You know nothing about any of this.
You are a trusted friend of Dragomir's.
Why'd you do it, Doctor?
Well, I couldn't let him destroy something so valuable. Don't you understand? This could be the key to everything.
Come on, Jack. I can't reach him in time because I'm the slowest out of you two. I've only
I could literally save hundreds of people with this. You don't understand. Dragomir thought that it was some sort of device of evil, some sort of satanic object. What nonsense. There's no such thing as Satan or the devil or any of that nonsense. What he didn't understand is this is a medical instrument, probably from some ancient civilization. It's a treasure that could never be destroyed. It's like, what a horrible thought. I didn't want to kill him, but I had to.
And how I wish this was like the 21st century where we can record him confessing.
Three witnesses.
I'd like you all to do psychology rolls on him.
Wow, my worst skill.
He seems fine.
92.
I got a 54 out of a 10, so no. Not going to happen on my end.
Simon?
No, I failed miserably.
All right. Well, he definitely seems crazed, but he's got an odd look on his face. Like he's listening to what he's saying.
Like he's listening to what he's saying? Kind of, yeah. Like he's sort of like an out-of-body type of a thing where...
No, like it all made sense a moment ago, and...
And right now...
He suddenly looks at you, and he suddenly goes into a tirade about the necessity of this. This is the most amazing... medical discovery of all, and if some people have to die, and as soon as he says that, you can see there's an internal struggle, and he's like, I didn't want to kill Dragomir. I love Dragomir. Dragomir was my best friend. And he just suddenly, you can see this look in his eyes like, Dragomir was my best friend. Dragomir was my best friend, and I shot him in the back like a dog. And he's just sort of shaking all over.
We've got to get that knife before the police get in.
Yeah.
If we don't get that knife before the police get here, and they're going to know about the knife's existence.
He came to me for help. He trusted me, and I killed him. God in heaven, what have I done? And at that point, he does drop the knife onto the table.
All right.
I'll try to work my way so I can grab the knife when I deal with him.
Okay.
Why don't you go over there and try to comfort him a bit while I grab the knife?
He's like, Dragomir wanted to destroy it. We went to the cement factory, and I realized what it was, and...
When we get a knife, let's get out as quick as possible. We can get out before the police come in. It'd be even better. Let the police would deal with him.
Yeah.
Well, he looks at you.
Conceal that dagger. Conceal it well.
All right. So you've got the dagger. He says, I can't believe what I've done. And there suddenly looks like this resolve comes over his face. And he reaches in his back pocket and pulls out a pistol. Okay. At which point he whistles, and all of a sudden from the other room come three more Coup de Vista things.
Oh no.
But they're not attacking. They walk over to him like they're his pets. Okay. And I won't even describe them, but I mean, just pick the weirdest combination of things. Mm-hmm. And, as each one comes up, he sort of gives it a little caress and then shoots it in the head and kills it.
Let's get out of it.
Yep.
And then with the last bullet, he blows his own brains out. Unless you want to stop him.
No.
You guys answered way too quickly.
Look, the police can't blame us for it. I want to get out of here without the police seeing us if I can.
Yep.
All right. It's possible for you, if you make the right rules, you could probably go over the back wall of the facility. I'll need you to pass a luck roll. At least, say Rupert has to pass a luck.
Oh, at least. I can imagine his climbing days are long gone. I'll get a 49 for my luck roll. My luck is 42.
Do you want to spend any luck?
I will do, yes.
How do you spend luck on using luck?
Yeah, that's not really fair, is it?
Yeah, you can't really do that.
All right.
I surrendered to the police. I mean, I came here to try and get an appointment, so I used the same alibi I used to get in. I've got a war wound. There's obviously something wrong with my leg. I'm a veteran, so I came here because of his reputation.
Well, to wrap it up, I'm going to say this. The police decided that this facility had something, in fact, to do with the People's Justice Army. Mm-hmm. And that Dr. Bellinzada was part of it, though that horrifies everyone. It takes some convincing, but you ultimately convince the police chief that you were victims in this case, that that he had been murdering people for his bizarre experiments, and that he had lured you here.
We promised to leave the country as soon as possible.
And that, yes, he wants you on the next train out of Vinco Vici, which means that you will be on the train. Let's see. Excuse my noises.
You need sanity rolls as well.
Yeah, we'll go over that in a second. You're heading towards Belgrade. That's your next stop. And
we'll start translating this book, aren't we?
Let's do this. Let's just simply, I'll give you a timetable when we get to Belgrade. So we'll just say that you get on the train, all of your stuff, everybody's with you. Jasmine is going to stay and make sure all of the rest of the things get sent to the guy in Sofia, Bulgaria. You have the books with you, and you have the Mem Sahis.
Yeah.
Phew.
What's the mental scars of what we saw?
Go ahead and do a sanity roll.
I succeed.
All right.
I do not.
Nope. I'm going to say that if you succeed, you're just going to take 1 point. If you fail, 1 to 4. But you're going to gain some back because you resolved this whole thing.
Well, all right.
Well, I lost 3. Well, how much are we getting back?
So I'll say I'll give you a 1d4 to roll to get sanity back.
3. That'll put me back up to 68.
Okay.
No, 68. No, 68. Yeah.
All right.
3.
So you are leaving Vinkovici and you are on your way to Belgrade. And in the interim, you will be reading the account of Tilius Corvus. So next week we will be playing characters from 330 AD.
Excellent.
Okay, I'll inform the others who were unfortunately unable to make it tonight. And we'll call it there.
Excellent.
Our players included Simon Ward, Jeff Wilkins, and Wayne Worthy, with myself as a keeper of the secrets. Please consider visiting our Patreon account. Just a few dollars a month will help us greatly. We're currently producing 4 shows a week, with music and sound effects added in post-production in order to create a richer listener experience. We're also providing audio-only versions of our show free for you to download from Podbean or iTunes. Feel free to send us comments. We'd love to hear from you. If you enjoyed our broadcast, please give us a thumbs up and subscribe to our channel for updates on our latest shows. You'll find links to everything I mentioned in the description below. This is Tom Rayleigh inviting you to journey with us once again into the darkness for another adventure into the universe of H.P. Lovecraft and the Call of Cthulhu role-playing game. Until next time, good luck and good gaming.